Abraham had the gospel. So we're talking about this Trinity discussion. Who or what spirit comes to dwell within genuine believers? Is it the generic spirit of God, like many Jews claim to have? Is it the spirit of Christ, like Christians claim to have? Or is it the Holy Spirit? Right? Who or what spirit brings about genuine salvation and the fellowship that is enjoyed by a genuine child of God, child of Abraham? The faith that Paul recognizes that brings about the salvation experience is none other than faith in Messiah. The genuine gospel was preached beforehand to Abraham. What does Paul say? This gospel says, or saying, in you shall all the nations be blessed. Now you're thinking, how is that the gospel? How is that the gospel? In you, Abraham, shall all the nations be blessed? Well, the bigger picture is that, and you have to go back and read through Genesis and follow through with the rest of the scriptures that convey this, but the idea is that Paul understood from a larger perspective that God was telling Abraham, I'm going to bless you, Abraham. I'm in a larger family, both naturally and spiritually. I'm going to bring about the birth of an offspring, of a member of your family, namely the Messiah, who through his sacrifice is going to bring and offer salvation to anyone who places their trust in him. This is going to be typified, of course, by the sacrifice that we're going to read, that we would read about in the Tanakh if we were from Abraham's perspective. But God gave Abraham enough of this gospel that Jew and Gentile can be made righteous in God as they place their faith in Messiah instead of changing their ethnicity. God gave enough of this gospel message to Abraham that it was encapsulated in the phrase, "In you shall all the nations be blessed." The key to understanding the scope of the gospel in this statement that Paul lifts from various places throughout the Tanakh, but most specifically in Genesis chapter 12, is that salvation is rooted in this faith in God's promises, not limited to whatever nation you come from. So from Abraham's perspective, it's important enough that Abraham knows that the nationals, the nations, those around you, they shall be blessed, not because they convert and become children of Abraham through conversion, but because they are going to eventually do the same thing that Abraham did, which is place their faith in that promise that God gave to Abraham, namely, the bringing in of the Messiah. This salvation, this genuine gospel that Paul preaches, ran counter to the pseudo-gospel that religious Jews were pushing in their day. Their version of gospel was limited to Jewish ethnicity and Torah maintenance. It was restricted by your social status. It wasn't offered to anyone from the nations until someone from nations lost that national status and took on Jewish status. That was their gospel. And that's why Paul says earlier in Galatians, if anyone comes and preaches another gospel, let them be accursed. Paul does not believe that genuine salvation is brought about by generic faith in God and conversion to Judaism. And of course, the gospel is certainly not restricted to whatever nationality you bring to the table. So this is the context of our understanding from modern Christian perspective of exactly what spirit is dwelling within us. Is it the generic spirit of God, like religious Jews claim to have? Or is it this exclusive spirit of Messiah that dwells in us that causes us to cry, Abba, Father, Daddy God, like Paul is going to talk about in Romans? Let's keep reading Galatians here. Verse 9, Paul says, so then, remember, he's challenging the Galatian Gentiles. Where is your loyalty? Where is your devotion? Where is your faith? What is the object of your faith? How is this going to affect your salvation? If you're going to move towards the object of faith known as conversion to Judaism and obedience to Torah, then you're going to end up in the wrong place, because that's not the genuine salvation that Abraham had. If you want to go down the path that Abraham walked and be counted as genuine sons and daughters of Abraham, and take that road of being blessed like Abraham was, then Paul's going to say it this way. those who are of faith, and he's talking within the context of salvation-based faith. And we're closing with this, by the way. Salvation-based faith, genuine faith in Messiah. These ones, they are the blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So this is the way we understand the exclusive nature of the Spirit of God. Yes, it becomes difficult for us to articulate. Is it God's Spirit that's in me? Is it the Spirit of Jesus that's in me? Is it the Holy Spirit? Don't think too hard. Just say yes. It is God's Spirit, because God's Spirit is Messiah's Spirit, and the Spirit of Messiah is the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is very God. The full deity of the Holy Spirit is seen in the overlapping of the Spirit, the way he's described throughout the Bible. Arguably, since this is the particular person that we're talking about right now in our Trinity study, arguably, the Spirit is not the front man. He's the behind-the-scenes guy. He's the one pulling strings or pushing buttons, but from an invisible perspective. Hello, he's a spirit. Last time I checked, you can't see spirits. Unless he wants to pull a little theophany and show up looking like a dove, or showing up sounding like a mighty rushing wind, or tongues of fire that land on your head. He can do that if he wants. He's fully God. He can theophanate. I'm making up a word again, right? He can pull a theophany like God does, right? He has that capacity. But for the most part, he's invisible. He's a spirit.